Okay, you see.
So in next third node point, two bodies having masses m1 and m2, both travel along the same straight line. Okay, before collision, the velocity of first body is u1, second body is u2 before collision. Okay, here whenever the elastic collision takes place between them, during collision, the two bodies comes like this, so that one body exert the force on the other body. So during collision, the two bodies travel with the common velocity. So, and moreover, during collision, as the two bodies are in contact, this body exert more force on this body, that is say action. At the same time, the second body also exert the reaction force on the first body. Due to that, the shape changes occurs here. That means whenever the bodies undergo shape changes, then we can say deformation take place in the body. So during deformation, the two bodies travel with common velocity. This is the common velocity, VCC, common velocity. After collision is over, here during deformation, as one body exert the force on the other body, first body exert the force on the second body, that is action. At the same time, second body exert the force on the first body, that is the reaction. Due to that, the velocity of the first body decreases and the velocity of the second body increases. But at the same time, as deformation takes place, that means shape changes occurs, deformation takes place. For the to deform the body, some energy is required. That's why in the kinetic energy of the system, some energy is consumed to deform the bodies. That's why some kinetic energy is lost temporarily during deformation. Due to that, shape changes occurs. Whatever the kinetic energy lost by these two bodies during deformation, such energy is stored in the bodies as the potential energy because of deformation. As the bodies undergo deformation, whatever the kinetic energy lost during deformation, such loss of kinetic energy is stored in the two bodies as the deforming energy or potential energy. With the remaining kinetic energy, the two bodies travel with constant velocity Vc. It is the common velocity. Vc is the common velocity. After exchange of momenta is over, due to force exerted by one body on the other body, which is the internal force, whenever exchange of momenta is over, after that, they are moving separately. So after collision, the two bodies move with different velocities, say V1 and V2. It is after collision. Already we know this one. Now, what is the impulse? Impulse means linear impulse or simply impulse. Impulse is represented with J. Impulse means whenever a surge of force acts on a body, that means whenever one body makes collision with this one, the body exerts a large force on a body in a small interval of time. When collision takes place between the two bodies, in that collision, one body exerts a large amount of force on a body in a small interval of time. Such force is called the impulsive force. And the time for which that force acts on a body is called the time of impulse. That impulsive time is very small and impulsive force is very large. So whenever there is, because of force exerted by one body on the other body in a small interval of time, then we can say the body receives an impulse. Because of that impulse received by the body, there is a change in momentum. So suppose the impulsive force received is equal to say F. F is equal to dP by dt, we can write now. dP by dt. Or dP is equal to F into dt. This is called impulse. So impulse is equal to F into t, we can write in general, or change in momentum. Impulse is equal to change in linear momentum of the body. Suppose due to different forces acts on a body in different directions, what is the change in momentum of the total change in momentum of the body? The total impulse is also a vector quantity, because in this impulse, F into T, F is a vector quantity. That's why impulse is also a vector quantity. That impulse lies along the direction of change in momentum. So whatever the direction of the change in momentum, in which direction change in momentum occurs, along the same direction, the impulse lies. So due to different forces acts on a body for different intervals of time, that net change in momentum or net impulse is equal to first force acting on a body into t1 plus second force acting on a body for a time t2 seconds is f2 d2, impulse due to first force, impulse due to second force, and so on. This is the net impulse received by the body. This net impulse received by the body is equal to net change in linear momentum of your body. Net change in linear momentum of your body means final momentum of your body minus initial momentum of your body. This is the formula for impulse in general. Here in this case, what is the impulse of deformation? And whenever the body makes collision with this one, due to that the shape changes occurs. At that time they move with constant velocity. What is the formula for constant velocity? According to law of conservation of linear momentum, before collision, the momentum of this body is m1 u1, momentum of the second body is m2 u2. That is equal to after collision, during collision, what is the momentum of the system? Here the law of conservation of linear momentum is applicable before collision, after collision also. During collision, as the both bodies travel with the common velocity, then these two bodies can be treated as a single body of mass m1 and m1 plus m2 into common velocity vc. Therefore, common velocity vc is equal to m1 u1 plus m2 u2 by m1 plus m2. So this is the common velocity. Now, what is the impulse due to deformation? Impulse of deformation. So therefore, impulse of deformation. And because of deformation of the bodies, what is the impulse received by the first body or second body? Both are same. Impulse of deformation, comma J suffix D. Impulse of deformation, that is equal to J suffix D. Because of this body, whenever it makes collision with this one, during collision, it travel with a common velocity. That's why impulse of deformation of the first body is equal to M1 U1 minus M1 into VC. M1 U1 minus M1 into VC. That means common velocity. Okay, next, for the second body, impulse of deformation is equal to m2 into common velocity vc minus m2 into v2, u2. M2 vc minus, because of deformation here, the impulse received by the body is equal to m2 vc minus m2 u2. During deformation, the common velocity is vc. That's why momentum of this body is m2 vc, which is greater than this one. That's why m2 vc minus m2 u2 is the impulse of deformation of the second body. Both are equal. Next, after deformation is over, because of deformation, as one body exerts force on the other body, exchange of momentum takes place. Of course, this will happen in a short interval of time, fraction of second. And after that, they are separating away each other. When they are separating away each other, that slowly the bodies again regaining their shapes. During deformation, shape changes occurs, but after collision is over, then slowly the bodies come back to the original shapes. While before they lose contact with each other, at that time the shape changes gradually come back. They are retaining their shapes or reforming their shapes, and whenever complete reformation takes place, then they travel with velocities v1 and v2. This is after collision or after reformation. Reformation means they regain their original shapes. After they get their original shapes, they travel with velocities v1 and v2. So after reformation, velocities of the two bodies are v1 and v2. Then what is the impulse of reformation? Impulse of reformation is represented with Jr. That impulse of reformation is equal to, you see, during collision or during deformation, velocity is vc. After deformation, velocity of the first body becomes v1. This is greater than this one. That's why m1 vc minus m1 v1, that is the impulse received by the first body due to reformation. For second body, that is also equal to, in case of second body, m2 v2 minus m2 into vc. It is the impulse of reformation. Both you will get same. impulse received by the second body during deformation, both are same. You will get same values. So this is also very, very important for advance also. Even though it is this concept is easy, but that is important point. Okay, next, in case of elastic collision, the transformation of energy from first body to second body. Already we observed the fraction of kinetic energy transferred from first body to second body is equal to 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. No, 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 square whole square. Okay. 4m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square. That is the fraction of kinetic energy transferred to the second body or fraction of kinetic energy lost by the first body. Okay. Next, fraction of kinetic energy retained by the first body means that is equal to m2 minus m1 by m1 minus m2 whole square. Okay. So here, that means during collision, in case of elastic collision, kinetic energy transformation takes place from first body to the second body. At what condition there is a large transformation of kinetic energy from the first body to second body means here energy transformation takes place or energy lost from first body to second body. So in elastic collision, energy transformation or kinetic energy transformation takes place is maximum when both bodies are having same masses, m1 and m2 are equal, and second body is at rest initially. Then only there is a strong interaction. Whenever the second body is at rest and first body travels with certain velocity, then relative velocity becomes maximum. Due to that, strong interaction takes place between them and a large exchange of momenta takes place, so that maximum kinetic energy is transferred from first body to second body. That's why in elastic collision, kinetic energy transformation takes place from one body to another body. That becomes maximum when masses are equal and second body is at rest. Okay. Next, here this is regarding to the elastic collision. So inelastic collision. Next, whatever the maximum potential energy stored here, last point in this elastic collision, here we say initial kinetic energies of the two bodies are this one, sum of these two, half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square. After collision, during collision, as the velocity of the two bodies are same, then kinetic energy of the system of two bodies during deformation or during collision is equal to half m1 plus m2 into vc square. So there is a loss of energy during collision. To deform the bodies in contact. అంటే బాడీస్ కొలిన్స్ అనే టైంలో షేప్ చేంజ్ అవుతుంది కాబట్టి వీటి యొక్క కైంటిక్ ఎనర్జీస్ కొంత లాస్ అయ్యి అవి షేప్ చేంజ్ కావడానికి కన్జ్యూమ్ అవుతాయి. సో వాట్ ఎవర్ ద ఎనర్జీ కైంటిక్ ఎనర్జీ కన్జ్యూమ్ టు అండర్గో ద షేప్ చేంజెస్ ఆర్ టు అండర్గో డిఫార్మేషన్ ఇన్ ద బాడీస్ డ్యూరింగ్ కొలిజన్ దట్ ఈస్ స్టోర్డ్ ఇన్ ద టూ బాడీస్ యాజ్ ద పొటెన్షియల్ ఎనర్జీ. ఓకే, సో వాట్ ఈస్ ద మాక్సిమం పొటెన్షియల్ ఎనర్జీ స్టోర్డ్ ఇన్ ద సిస్టమ్? మాక్సిమం పొటెన్షియల్ ఎనర్జీ స్టోర్డ్ in the system, maximum potential energy stored in the system due to deformation or during collision, comma delta u is equal to before collision kinetic energy is this one, so half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square. During collision kinetic energy of the system is, during collision, as both bodies travel with the common velocity, then kinetic energy of the system during collision is half into m1 plus m2 into common velocity square. So this amount of energy is disappeared in the two bodies whenever they travel with the same velocity during deformation or during collision. So such loss of energy, kinetic energy, is converted into potential energy to deform the bodies, and that energy is stored in the bodies as the potential energy. That's why maximum potential energy in the system due to deformation is equal to, that is the formula. Okay, so this is regarding elastic collision. Next, inelastic collision. Next subheading, inelastic collision. Inelastic collision means perfectly inelastic collision. Inelastic collision or perfectly inelastic collision, both are same. Perfectly inelastic collision. The collision in which Sai Ganesh Sai Ganesh what is your doubt Sai Ganesh Sai Ganesh
sir impulse of deformation ardhankala sir
impulse of deformation impulse of sir. Deformation means suppose in case of first body having mass m1 initially moving with a velocity u1 no during deformation yes, both bodies travel with the same velocity or common velocity no at that time because of impulse what is the change in moment of the first body so change in moment of the first body means initial moment means more so m1 u1 minus during deformation as the both bodies travel with the common velocity vc then the momentum of the first body during deformation is equal to m1 into vc that's why m1 u1 minus m1 into vc that is the okay. impulse of deformation okay
focus
okay Sai Ganesh
sir
okay Sai Ganesh you respond loudly okay Sai Ganesh
yes sir
ah okay correct
oh yes sir
okay no okay. next inelastic collision perfectly inelastic collision or inelastic collision both are same here suppose there are two bodies having masses m1 m2 initially moving at velocities u1 and u2 if perfectly inelastic collision takes place between the two bodies then after collision the two bodies travel with common velocity vc or simply v whatever it may be before collision and after collision so the collision in which the two bodies travel together after collision the collision between the two bodies due to which the two bodies travel together after collision such type of collision is called the perfect inelastic collision or simply inelastic collision for any kind of collision the bodies obeys the law of conservation of linear momentum for any type of collision the bodies obeys the law of conservation of linear momentum so therefore in this form here from this diagram according to law of conservation of linear momentum the inelastic collision means that is the collision in which bodies obeys law of conservation of linear momentum but not law of conservation of kinetic energy okay that is called inelastic collision here in this collision bodies obeys law of conservation of linear momentum but does not obeys the law of conservation of kinetic energy such type of collision is called inelastic collision so according to law of conservation of linear momentum we can write m1 u1 plus m2 u2 as both bodies travel in the same direction I have taken plus only suppose if this body travel in opposite direction we have to write minus sign okay is equal to after collision as the two bodies come in together and move with same velocity then these two bodies can be treated as a single body having mass m1 plus m2 into common velocity vc. Therefore, common velocity in this case, common velocity vc is equal to m1 u1 plus m2 u2 by m1 plus m2. Suppose initially, if the second body is at rest, then we have to substitute u2 is equal to 0. Then same, formula is same. Okay, here in this collision, in inelastic collision, bodies does not obey law of conservation of kinetic energy principle. Because whenever collision occurs, no doubt as force exerted by one body on the other body, shape changes occurs or deformation takes place. But even after collision also, the deformation is permanently retained with the bodies. They cannot regain their original shapes. That's why to retain their shape, to deform their shape, some kinetic energy is consumed. They cannot be recollected back. That's why some kinetic energy is lost. That's why whenever inelastic collision takes place, then there is a loss of kinetic energy by the system. In case of elastic collision, there is no loss of kinetic energy by the system, but one body loses kinetic energy, and whatever the loss of kinetic energy by one body in the elastic collision, that is transferred to the other body, because there is no loss of kinetic energy by the system. They obey law of conservation of kinetic energy principle. That's why there is no loss of kinetic energy by the system, but one body loses kinetic energy, other body gains that kinetic energy, but no loss of kinetic energy by the system. But here there is a loss of kinetic energy by the system. That loss of kinetic energy, a part of loss of kinetic energy by the system, is utilized to deform the bodies. That means to change the shape of the bodies. Some energy may be lost in the form of sound energy. Some energy may be lost in the form of heat energy, like that. So whenever collision occurs, we can hear the sound. No, that means some kinetic energy of those bodies due to collision, some kinetic energy is lost or converted in the form of sound energy. That's why whenever collision occurs, we can hear the sound. Some kinetic energy may be lost in the form and generated in the form of heat energy. Some kinetic energy is utilized to change the shape of the bodies or to deform the bodies. That's why here there is a loss of kinetic energy by the system in case of inelastic collision. So what is that loss of kinetic energy? Loss of kinetic energy by the system, that is important. Loss of kinetic energy by the system. Loss of kinetic energy by the system, delta E is equal to initial kinetic energy of the system minus final kinetic energy of the system. Initial kinetic energy means before collision, the kinetic energies of the two bodies is half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square. Half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square minus final kinetic energy of the system means after collision, as the two bodies move together, such type of collision is the inelastic. So inelastic collision means the collision in which the bodies obeys law of conservation of linear momentum, but not law of conservation of kinetic energy. Such type of collision is called inelastic collision. That is one type of definition. Another type of definition is the collision in which the bodies move together after collision. Such type of collision is also called as the inelastic collision. So after collision, as the two bodies move together with the same speed v, then what is the kinetic energy of the system after collision? That is the final kinetic energy. After collision, as the two bodies move together, the total mass of the two bodies can be treated as a single body of mass m1 plus m2 into common velocity square. Common velocity means already we are having this formula now. Common velocity, m1 u1 plus m2 u2 by m1 plus m2, you substitute there. So half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square minus half m1 plus m2 into vc means m1 u1 plus m2 u2 whole by m1 plus m2 square is there, square. Okay, you expand them, a plus b whole square, expand them, take LCM, and if you simplify them, then what is the value you will get? I will write that one. Half m1 m2 by, of course you do calculation there, m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square.
So this is the loss of kinetic energy by the system. Half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square.
it is the loss of kinetic energy by the system due to inelastic collision. Just a plus b whole square, then you take LCM and simplify them directly, you will get this formula. Of course, lengthy here somewhat, you will get 6-7 steps like this. That's why I did not write. Okay, but you will get this direct formula: half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square. Okay, so this is the loss of kinetic energy by the system whenever inelastic collision takes place. Related to this one, now we have to discuss the some applications or some note points. Okay, right, next, some applications related to inelastic collision. Already I sent notes to you. I kept in WhatsApp group also yesterday, I think. Yesterday or day before yesterday? Yesterday, I think I kept in the WhatsApp group also. Okay, now note points. Ballistic pendulum. First one, ballistic pendulum. First application, ballistic pendulum. Actually, ballistic pendulum is the device. Ballistic pendulum is the device by means of which the speed of the bullet fired from the gun can be determined. Okay, ballistic pendulum means that is the device which is used to find the velocity of the bullet with which it is fired from the gun. Okay, how? Actually, in ballistic pendulum, a wooden block is suspended by means of inextensible string from the rigid support. Light, here it is the inextensible light string. By means of this, a wooden block is suspended. This is the wooden block of mass capital M. It is the wooden block of mass capital M. Okay, it is wooden block. Okay. Here the length of the string, of course, compared with the length of the string, these dimensions are negligible. That's why length of the pendulum in a ballistic pendulum is, say, L. This length is L. Now, one bullet is fired from the gun. The mass of the bullet is M and velocity is, say, U. Here the velocity with which the bullet fired from the gun, or the muzzle velocity of the bullet is, say, U. Muzzle velocity means velocity with which the bullet fired from the gun, that is called muzzle velocity. If the muzzle velocity of the bullet is U, then mass of the bullet is, say, M. With this velocity, when it is fired into the wooden block, initially, whenever the wooden block is at rest, it comes to rest at the lowest position, A. It comes to rest and it is under equilibrium at the lowest position, A. But whenever the bullet strikes the wooden block, the bullet penetrates into the wooden block, and suppose it remains embedded in it. If bullet wooden block lo penetrate ape dantlone undipoyind ankonde appudu rendu kalisi move avutayi ga rendu kalisi with what common velocity the two can move together with what common velocity after collision. So according to law of conservation of linear momentum, before collision the moment of the system of wooden block and bullet, moment of the bullet is mu plus, as the wooden block is at rest initially. Here u1 is equal to u1 is equal to u, u2 is equal to 0. So plus capital M into wooden velocity of the wooden block is 0 initially. Okay, after collision, as the bullet penetrates into the wooden block and remains embedded in it, the both move together with the common velocity, say vc. Okay, therefore, as both bodies move together with the common velocity, then the total mass of the system m plus m into common velocity vc. Therefore, common velocity vc is equal to, we can write mu by m plus capital M. Okay, it is the common velocity. So with this common velocity, suppose this wooden block is kept on the smooth horizontal floor, If wooden block is kept on the smooth horizontal floor, then both will move together with the constant speed Vc on the smooth horizontal floor. But as it is suspended by this one, then this wooden block along with the bullet rises up to certain height until their velocity becomes zero. So suppose the wooden block rises up to this height. The wooden block rises up to this height, say, until their velocity becomes zero. The wooden block rises like this. If it is not suspended by means of a string, the wooden block along with the bullet travel in forward direction. But because as it is suspended by means of a string, the wooden block rises up to certain height until their velocity becomes zero. Until their velocity becomes zero. Length of the string as usual L only. Okay. So before their velocity becomes zero, up to what height the wooden block rises? This is the height up to which the wooden block rises, say. That means initially whenever the body is here, it is having kinetic energy. But when it reaches up to certain height, the total kinetic energy is lost as velocity becomes zero and it is converted into potential energy. Now you apply the conservation of energy principle. We cannot apply the conservation of, you see, we cannot apply the conservation of mechanical energy principle from before firing. Before collision, we cannot apply because whenever it makes collision with this one, some kinetic energy is lost and that is generated in the form of heat energy. That's why law of conservation of mechanical energy is applied, cannot be applied before collision. But after collision, whenever this starts moving with common velocity Vc, at that time we can apply the law of conservation of mechanical energy here and here. Why? After starts moving with common velocity, it rises and move against the gravity. Due to that, work is done by the gravity only. When work is done by the gravity, then in such case, the total mechanical energy is not lost. One form of energy will be converted into another form. That's why, according to law of conservation of mechanical energy, law of conservation of mechanical energy, total energy at A, total energy of the system at A is equal to total energy of the system at B. Total energy of the system at A means here bullet and wooden block both move together with common velocity. No? So kinetic energy of the system is half small m plus capital M into common velocity square. Plus potential energy is zero. Because it is the lowest point, that's why you take this lowest point of the wooden block as the reference line or reference plane. Whenever it reaches the height h before it comes to rest, then that is equal to at B, it is having potential energy m plus capital M into g into h. Plus, as the velocity is zero, kinetic energy is equal to half m plus capital M into zero. Zero square or zero. Here, m plus m cancel. Okay, therefore, from this Vc square is equal to, do cross multiplication, 2z into h. H we know, Vc means common velocity. Mu by m plus capital M. Okay, square is there, so whole square. Is equal to 2z into h. Or mu by m plus capital M is equal to root 2zh. Or u means velocity of the bullet. Therefore, velocity of bullet, comma u is equal to, you write, m plus m by small m plus capital M by small m into root 2zh. This is the velocity of the bullet. Just mass of the wooden block, mass of the bullet we know, we will be given. And height up to which the system rises, that can be had by ballistic pendulum. So if we know h value, we can assess with what velocity the bullet is fired. Whenever the bullet is fired, even we cannot see that bullet. That's why we cannot measure directly the velocity of the bullet. We cannot see the velocity of the, we cannot see the bullet whenever it is fired. That's why by this ballistic pendulum, we can measure the velocity of the bullet like this. Okay. So this is one application of the ballistic pendulum. Okay, next. Sometimes, whenever the bullet penetrates into the wooden block and emerges out, sometimes you will be given like that. In such case, what is the height up to which the wooden block rises? In such a way, they may ask. Suppose, here there is a wooden block. Bullet is fired with a velocity u1. Mass of the bullet is m and velocity of the bullet u1 is equal to say u. Mass of the wooden block is capital M and their initial velocity is zero. whenever bullet is fired into the wooden block, after fired, the bullet penetrates through this wooden block and emerges out with a velocity v1, and this wooden block travel with a velocity v2 after bullet comes out from the wooden block. In that case, what is the height up to which the wooden block rises? That is the question they ask. Suppose after firing, whenever the bullet comes out from the wooden block, with what velocity the wooden block travel? That is say v2. If you know v2, the height up to which the body rises means root 2gh, you know, v2 is equal to root 2gh. Because if the wooden block comes out, wooden block starts motion with a velocity this one, then it rises until their velocity becomes zero. So you apply the conservation of energy principle for a wooden block. Initially, at this point, it is having kinetic energy half mv2 square. Whenever it rises up to certain height, its velocity becomes zero. So it is having only potential energy. So half capital M v2 square is equal to capital M g into h. Then v2 is equal to root 2 g h, you know. So that's why you apply the here for any type of collision. Is it inelastic collision? Ballistic pendulum. Okay, Sahith. Ballistic pendulum means that is the pendulum by means of which the velocity of the bullet can be determined. In this one, wooden block is suspended. Okay. So here, in this case, any type of collision obeys law of conservation of linear momentum. So along this direction, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, before collision, the momentum of the bullet is small m into u plus momentum of the block, wooden block, is m into zero. After collision, momentum of the bullet is m into v1 plus momentum of the block is capital M into v2. Okay. From this formula, you find v2. V t is equal to root 2 g h. Okay. Here, v t is equal to root 2 g h. H can be calculated. Now, v1 will be given. U is known. Capital M, small m are given. H can be calculated. Now, so by using these formulas, we can find up to what height the bullet rises. The wooden block rises, we can calculate. Okay, next. Sometimes you will be given on the smooth horizontal surface, there are three blocks on the smooth horizontal surface. There are three blocks A, B, C. Here mass of this block is MA. Here it is MB. Of course, this is MB. The masses may be equal or may not be equal. This is MB and here it is MC. These two blocks are joined by means of a spring having spring constant K. Okay, now this block A is pushed in this direction, or an impulse is given to the block A so that it starts motion with a velocity UA initially. But these two are at rest. Here, in between A and B, between A and B, inelastic collision will be taken place. Inelastic means perfect inelastic. Inelastic collision takes place. That is given in the problem only. Okay. Now, what is the maximum compression of the spring in this case? Here, in between these two, inelastic collision takes place. Then, maximum compression in the spring. Comma, x is x max. That is equal to question mark. It is the question they asked. First of all, here we see, whenever this block makes collision with this one, as inelastic collision takes place between these two bodies stick together now. Due to that,
after collision with what common velocity the block B starts their motion? First we have to find. Okay, whenever these two here for A and B blocks, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, because any type of collision obeys law of conservation of linear momentum, no? According to law of conservation of linear momentum, after collision what is the velocity of these two blocks? Because after the inelastic collision the two bodies stick together, merge together, combine together and travel with common velocity. What is that common velocity? We had to find first. So according to law of conservation of linear momentum, ma into ua is the momentum of this one. Before collision it is at rest, that's why momentum of this body is zero, is equal to after collision both bodies move together, that's why total mass of the a and b is this one, into common velocity say v. Therefore common velocity v is equal to ma ua by ma plus mb. It is the common velocity. With this common velocity the two blocks together starts motion. Two blocks together starts motion with this velocity v. So whenever this two blocks starts motion, then immediately this spring starts compression. Whenever spring starts compression, then at the time some spring force is developed. That spring force pushes this block in this direction. The same spring force pushes this system of A and B in backward direction. Due to that, the velocity of A and B decreases and velocity of C increases. And whenever these two, the total system move with common velocity, up to that the spring is compressive. Whenever these two wheels, these three blocks moving with common velocity, at that time the compression will be stopped. After that again the compression changes, but maximum compression decreases, but whenever maximum compression takes place, at that time the total system will move with common velocity. That common velocity we have to find. If you know the common velocity after collision, after maximum compression takes place, then what is the energy stored in the spring can be estimated. Okay, that's why here you see when these two blocks together move with common velocity, at that time the energy of the mechanical energy of the entire system is equal to half into only it is having kinetic energy. When maximum compression takes place, you see, no doubt the block A and block B combine together and compression takes place, so that maximum compression takes place, that is X max. Okay, then this is the block C. The entire system will travel with common velocity, whenever maximum compression takes place, at the time the two all blocks travel with the same velocity. That common velocity of the entire system is say V dash, that is called question mark. Here also we can apply the law of conservation of linear momentum. Okay, in this case you see, before starts compression the momentum of this system, means that is equal to, of course we can write like this only, even collision takes place or collision not takes place, the entire system obeys law of conservation of linear momentum. As two bodies move together, total mass ma plus mb into this velocity, that velocity is equal to v, no? That means you substitute this one, ma plus mb into this common velocity, mu ma ua by ma plus mb. These two cancel, again you will get this only, no? That's why ma plus ua is the momentum of the system before it starts compression. Whenever maximum compression takes place, three bodies travel with the same velocity, that's why ma plus mb plus mc into common velocity v dash. So v dash is equal to ma ua by ma plus mb plus mc. This is equation 2. So whenever maximum compression takes place, at that time the system, entire system will travel with this common velocity. Okay, so at that time what you apply the conservation of energy principle, conservation of mechanical energy principle can be conservation of mechanical energy principle can be applied only after collision takes place between these two. So initial kinetic energy of the system before starts compression is the kinetic energy of this system, half ma plus mb into common velocity is v, no, v square. Okay, after maximum compression takes place, as three bodies travel with the same velocity, kinetic energy of the system after maximum compression takes place is equal to half ma plus mb plus mc into common velocity v dash square. Okay, plus whenever this entire system travel with common velocity v dash, at that time as the compression takes place, some energy of this system of A and B is stored in the spring as the potential energy. That's why this is equal to half k into maximum compression square. You substitute everything, you can find this x max. In this way we can find the x max. Such type of questions they asked in advance. Okay, Varshit Reddy, what is your doubt? It will not obey. No, law of conservation of linear momentum is obeyed at any time, but law of conservation of kinetic energy principle does not obey in inelastic collision. That's why I did not apply the law of conservation of kinetic energy principle before inelastic collision. After collision, as the two bodies move together, now we can apply the law of conservation of mechanical energy principle here. I applied the law of conservation of mechanical energy. Okay, after collision, these two bodies travel with velocity v. That's why kinetic energy of the system is this one. After these three blocks travel with common velocity when maximum compression takes place, this total kinetic energy is divided into two parts, because some part of kinetic energy is stored in the spring as the potential elastic potential energy in the spring, and remaining energy, elastic potential energy in the spring, and remaining energy is equal to kinetic energy of this entire system. This is divided into two parts. Here conservation of energy principle is applicable here before, after inelastic collision, but before inelastic collision conservation of mechanical energy is not applicable, because due to inelastic collision some energy is lost, no, due to inelastic collision. That's why before inelastic collision we cannot apply the law of conservation of mechanical energy principle. Here applied law of conservation of mechanical energy, not law of conservation of kinetic energy. It is the law of conservation of mechanical energy, according to law of conservation of mechanical energy, because here work is done by spring force on the blocks. Spring force is a conservative. If work is done by the conservative force, there is no loss of mechanical energy, but one form of energy will be converted into another form. Okay, so this is the situation. Now so in this way we have to do. Next, semi elastic collision. Third type of collision is the semi elastic collision. Semi elastic collision. Here in case of semi elastic collision, the bodies obeys law of conservation of linear momentum, but law of conservation of kinetic energy as said earlier. But in case of semi elastic collision, it obeys the Newton's law of restitution. So before going to discuss in detail about semi elastic collision, first we have to know what is the line of impact. Suppose there are two bodies. This is one body, this is another body. Suppose this body having certain mass, say m1, it is say m2. M2 is at rest initially. This body travel along this direction. Here this body travel in this direction.
with certain velocity, with velocity say u1. This is at rest initially. So while traveling in this direction, at the instant whenever they collide each other, at the time the point where the two bodies are in contact is this one. Of course, after collision, definitely the velocity of this body decreases and the velocity of this body increases. ఎందుకంటే కొలిజన్ జరిగిన తర్వాత డెఫినెట్ గా ఈ బాడీ కొంత వెలాసిటీతో ట్రావెల్ చేస్తుంది కదా. సో వై, వాట్ ఈస్ ద రీజన్ హౌ ద వై ద ది సెకండ్ బాడీ స్టార్ట్స్ మోషన్? డెఫినెట్లీ సమ్ ఫోర్స్ వుడ్ బి యాక్టెడ్ ఆన్ ది బాడీ డ్యూ టు దిస్, డ్యూ టు కొలిజన్. సో వాట్ ఈస్ ద డైరెక్షన్ ఆఫ్ దట్ ఫోర్స్ యాక్ట్స్? ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు నో దెమ్ డ్యూరింగ్ కొలిజన్, ద పాయింట్ ఆఫ్ కాంటాక్ట్ ఈస్ హియర్. అట్ దిస్ పాయింట్ ఆఫ్ కాంటాక్ట్ యు డ్రా ఏ కామన్ టాంజెంట్, యు డ్రా ఏ కామన్ టాంజెంట్. దిస్ ఈస్ ద కామన్ టాంజెంట్ డ్రాన్ టు ద two bodies at the point of contact. It is common tangent. Common tangent. Perpendicular to common tangent, passing through point of contact, you draw a line. Exactly along this direction only, during collision, one body exerts force on the other body. Suppose, as this body makes collision with this one, because of collision, this body exerts some force or impulsive force on this body along this line. That is a action. At the same time, this also exerts the reaction force on the body in this direction. So, because during interaction or during collision, along which direction the one body exerts the force on the other body, that is called line of impact. So, line of impact is this one. Line of impact. Line of impact. So, this is the line of impact. Line of impact. This is the line of impact. Along this line of impact, only one body exerts force on the other body. Along the line of impact only, because of force exerted by one body on the other body, the velocity of the bodies undergo changes. Perpendicular to this direction, that means along common tangent, there is no change in the velocities of the bodies. You remember that is a very, very important point. Along the line of impact only, as one body exerts the force on the other body, the velocities of the two bodies changes. Of course, velocity of this body increases, velocity of this body decreases along the line of impact only. Perpendicular to line of impact, that means along common tangent, there is no change in the velocities of the two bodies. So, along line of impact, velocities of the bodies changes. Velocities of the bodies changes. Along common tangent, along common tangent or perpendicular to line of impact, no change in velocities of the bodies, no change in velocity of bodies. So now suppose there are two bodies. In case of one-dimensional collision, because in this week we are having only one-dimensional collision. So in one-dimensional collision, in case of one-dimensional collision, these are the two bodies having masses m1, m2. This body travel with a velocity u1 initially before collision. This body travel with a velocity u2. Of course, u1 greater than u2 to make collision. After collision, the first body travel with a velocity v1, second body travel with a velocity, say, v2. It is before collision. It is after collision. Okay. After collision, as the velocity here, already we know previously we discussed the same type only. The before collision, the two bodies travel along the same straight line. After collision also, the two bodies travel along the same straight line. Such type of collision is called one dimensional collision. No, one dim, okay, mass of the spring is negligible. No, here somebody else, Sahith, asked me the doubt that in finding common velocity, why you did not mention the spring force while
finding the common velocity, the moment of the spring is zero because spring has negligible mass. Even though the spring is having mass, as it has, even though the spring is moving with same velocity as that of the three blocks or two blocks, the mass of the spring is negligible. That's why moment of the spring is negligible, zero, no? That's why moment of the spring is not taken into account. Suppose if the mass of the spring is also considerable, then moment of the spring is to be taken into account. Okay, Siddharth, Sahith, are you clarified now? Siddharth and Sahith, come on, you respond immediately. Okay, right. So you see, before collision, the velocities of the two bodies are this one, after collision, that one. Here you see, during collision, at the point of contact, you draw a common tangent, and perpendicular to common tangent, when you draw the lines, the line passing through point of contact perpendicular to common tangent, that is along this line. That's why this is line of impact. It is line of impact. Along line of impact, before collision, the two bodies comes closer now, because velocity u1 is greater than u2. That's why before collision, the two bodies comes closer. That's why before collision, they are having relative velocity of approach. So what is the relative velocity of approach? Relative velocity of approach. Okay, relative velocity of approach is u1 minus u2. Okay, but after collision, as the two bodies travel with velocities v1 and v2, v2 greater than v1 definitely, because this velocity decreases after collision, this velocity increases. That's why v2 becomes greater than v1. That's why after collision, the two bodies travel away each other, no? They are separating away each other, no? That's why after collision, there is a relative velocity of separation. Relative velocity of separation. Relative velocity of separation is v2 minus v1, because v2 greater, v2 minus v1. That is the relative velocity of separation. So along line of impact, only, the ratio between the relative velocity of separation to the relative velocity of approach, that is called coefficient of restitution. Coefficient of restitution. Coefficient of restitution. So coefficient of restitution means the ratio along the line of impact. Along line of impact, the ratio between the relative velocity of separation to the relative velocity of approach is called the coefficient of restitution. Okay, along line of impact only this formula can be applied. Along the line of impact only this formula can be applied. Relative velocity of separation is v2 minus v1. Relative velocity of approach is u1 minus u2. Okay, the ratio between these two is called coefficient of restitution. For elastic collision, E value is equal to 1. Because in case of elastic collision, already we proved that relative velocity of approach is equal to relative velocity of separation. Already we proved. That's why these two are equal. So they cancel each other. So E is equal to 1. Okay. For inelastic collision, in case of inelastic or perfectly inelastic collision, after collision, as the two bodies travel with the same velocity or common velocity, v2, v1 are equal. When these two are equal, it becomes zero. Zero by something, zero. That's why in case of inelastic collision, it is zero. In case of inelastic collision, coefficient of restitution is equal to zero. For semi-elastic collision, E value lies between 0 and 1. 0 less than E less than 1. For semi-elastic collision, the coefficient of restitution lies between 0 and 1. For semi-elastic collision, the 0 E value, that means coefficient of restitution value lies between 0 and 1. This coefficient of restitution has no units and no dimension formula. Because it is the ratio between two similar quantities. That's why it has no unit and no dimensional formula. Okay. So this is about coefficient of restitution. Now, in case of semi-elastic collision, when one-dimensional semi-elastic collision takes place, after collision, whatever the velocities of the two bodies, u1, u2 will be given, v1, v2, we have to derive. Formulas for v1, v2, you have to derive. here? Two bodies having masses m1 and m2 move along the same direction, and after semi-elastic collision takes place, the velocity of the first body becomes v1, velocity of second body becomes v2. Then what about the formulas for velocities of the two bodies? No doubt, before collision and after collision. It is before collision and it is after collision. So in case of any type of collision, in case of any type of collision, we can apply the law of conservation of linear momentum. Along line of impact also, we can apply the law of conservation of linear momentum, because along line of impact, the force exerted by one body on the other body is the internal force. Internal force does not alter the total momentum of the system. That's why along line of impact, we can apply the law of conservation of linear momentum. Okay. Semi-elastic collision means, here it is not the elastic collision. After collision, the two bodies never travel together. Such type of collision is called semi-elastic collision. Such type of collision is called semi-elastic collision. Here, the collision in which the bodies obeys law of conservation of linear momentum, but not law of conservation of kinetic energy. And moreover, after collision, the two bodies will not travel together. Such type of collision is called semi-elastic collision. Okay. Here, law of conservation of kinetic energy principle is not applicable, because here also some energy is lost due to collision. Okay, that's why here law of conservation of kinetic energy principle is not applicable. Right. But here, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, m1, u1, of course, for simplification, I have taken velocities in the same direction before collision. So m1, u1 plus m1, u1 plus m2, u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2. This is one equation we can derive. Next, as it is the semi-elastic collision along the line of impact, this is only line of impact. This is the line of impact. This is the line of impact direction. Along line of impact, we can apply the law of Newton's law of restriction. No? According to Newton's law of restriction, already I wrote, no, the ratio between the relative velocity of separation to the relative velocity of approach is constant and called coefficient of restitution. That is called Newton's law of restitution. So according to Newton's law of restitution, Newton's law of restitution, coefficient of along line of impact, that is important, along line of impact, E is equal to relative velocity of separation means V2 minus V1 by relative velocity of approach means U1 minus U2. Okay, that implies V2 minus V1 is equal to E into U1 minus U2. This is equation 2. In case of elastic collision, we got V2 minus V1 is equal to U1 minus U2. That means relative velocity of separation is equal to relative velocity of approach. But now, relative velocity of separation is equal to coefficient of restriction into relative velocity of approach. You will get, that is only the difference. Okay. In elastic collision, to obtain the formula for V1, we have taken V2 value from this equation and we substituted in this formula and we calculated V1. So, ikkada kuda you do the same thing. Ikkada V2 value, V1 value find out cheyali. V2 undakoddu deentlo. Appudu dee nunchi V2 value iskochi ikkada substitute cheyandi. Okay. From 2. V2 is equal to V1 plus E into U1 minus U2. No? Therefore, from 1, m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 into v2 means this one, v1 plus e into u1 minus u2. Okay, from this you solve formula for v1 is equal to, so after simplification, I think you can do simplification. After simplification, what is the value you will get? I am writing directly. Actually, whenever elastic collision takes place, we got m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 plus 2m2 by m1 plus m2 into u2 we got in case of elastic collision. Am I right?
in case of elastic collision, we got velocity of the first body after one dimensional elastic collision takes place is equal to m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 plus 2m2 by m1 plus m2 into u2. But in case of semi-elastic collision, one dimensional semi-elastic collision takes place here. After collision, velocity of the first body, same formula, a little bit change. At the place of minus, you write em2. At the place of 2, you write 1 plus e. That's all. Of course, if you simplify this for v1, then you will get this formula directly. Like this, you will get. It is the easy way to remember also. At the place of 2, you write 1 plus e. At the place of minus, you write e. In case of elastic collision, e is equal to 1. When you substitute e is equal to 1, m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2, here 1 plus 1, 2m2 by m1 plus m2 into u2, you will get like this. Okay. Similarly, for v2, what is the formula for v2? Tell me. What is the formula for v2? We got 2m1 by m1 plus m2 in elastic collision, I am telling, plus m2 minus m1 by m1 plus m2 into u2. We got, actually, in elastic collision, we got this one. Is it correct or not? Is it correct or not? You respond. Okay. In case of semi-elastic collision, at the place of 2, you write 1 plus e. That's all. At the place of e, you write, of course, from this formula, you see, to obtain v2 value, v2 formula, then from this equation, v1 is equal to something you write. V1 is equal to something. You see, v1 is equal to v2 minus e into u1 minus u2. No? You substitute that v1 value in this equation. Then you will get v2 is equal to something. Directly, you will get that formula. So, 1 plus e into m1 by m1 plus m2. Here, m2 minus em1 by m1 plus m2 into u2. You will get those formulas. So, in case of semi-elastic collision, the velocities of the two bodies, are m1 minus em2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 plus 1 plus e into m2 by m1 plus m2 into u2. Next one, v2 is equal to 1 plus e into m1 by m1 plus m2 into u1 plus m2 minus em1 by m1 plus m2 into u2. We got. Okay, now, in case of semi-elastic collision, what is the loss of kinetic energy by the system? Loss of kinetic energy by the system. Loss of kinetic energy by the system means initial kinetic energy of the system minus final kinetic energy of the system. Initial kinetic energy means half m1 u1 square plus half m2 v2 square, sorry, u2 square. Minus half. Final kinetic energy of the system means half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square. You substitute these v1, v2 values from this equation. V1 is this one, v2 is that one. You substitute. Okay? Then you simplify them. Then you will get delta E is equal to, after simplification I am writing, half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square into 1 minus e square. You will get that like this after simplification. Directly I have written, after simplification you will get half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square into 1 minus e square. Now, is it correct or not? You apply in case of perfect inelastic collision. In case of inelastic collision, as E is equal to 0, then you substitute here. Then loss of kinetic energy is equal to half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square. We got that formula only, no? Inelastic collision, loss of kinetic energy by the system, and we got formula half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square. We got formula adi. ఎందుకంటే లాస్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్ కేస్ ఆఫ్ ఇనెలాస్టిక్ కొలిజన్ ఈ ఈజ్ ఈక్వల్ టు 0 కాబట్టి అట్లా వస్తుంది. అదే ఎలాస్టిక్ కొలిజన్ అనుకోండి, కైనెటిక్ ఎనర్జీ లాస్ట్ బై ద సిస్టమ్. ఇన్ కేస్ ఆఫ్ ఎలాస్టిక్ కొలిజన్ మీన్స్ ఎలాస్టిక్ కొలిజన్ లో ఈజ్ ఈక్వల్ టు 1 1 మైనస్ 1 0. ఇన్ కేస్ ఆఫ్ ఎలాస్టిక్ కొలిజన్ దెర్ ఇస్ నో లాస్ ఆఫ్ కైనెటిక్ ఎనర్జీ బై ద సిస్టమ్. నో, ఒక బాడీ కైనెటిక్ ఎనర్జీ లాస్ అవుతుంది, ఇంకోటి గెయిన్ చేస్తుంది, కానీ కైనెటిక్ ఎనర్జీ లాస్ట్ బై ద సిస్టమ్ ఇస్ 0. Because E is equal to 1. So it is the most general expression for loss of kinetic energy by the system in case of any type of collision. It is applicable.
especially in case of semi-elastic. Okay, this is the most general formula for loss of kinetic energy by the system in case of any type of collision. So loss of kinetic energy by the system, not particle, by system. Tarvata nenu chaala mandi doubt adigindi entante WhatsApp group lo collision jariginappudu before collision or after collision mass of the bodies ivakunda radius of the sphere ichadu. Mass of the body is equal to volume into density. Volume ante as they are spheres, 4/3 pi r cube is the volume into density rho. Aithe two spheres are made with the same material ante rho constant e, 4/3 pi constant e, appudu mass is proportional to radius cube kada. Kabatti ive formulas lo mass place lo radius cube raaskunte saripothundi. Okay na, idi semi elastic collision, regarding semi elastic collision. Okay, now under semi-elastic collision, some note points we have to discuss. So note points. First one. One body is dropped from a height. A body having certain mass is dropped from a height h. One body is dropped from a height h. Okay. Then the body before makes collision, with what velocity the body makes collision? When the body is released from a height h before making first collision with the floor, having coefficient of restitution e, with what velocity it makes collision? As the body is dropped from a height h, the velocity with which it makes collision means the velocity acquired by this body before reaches the ground is equal to how much? √2gh, no? That's why √2gh. With this velocity the body makes collision with this one. It is the floor. So this body whenever released from a height h, it makes collision with the floor with a velocity u. And if it is the elastic collision, with the same velocity the body rebounds and reaches the same height, and again it falls, again reaches the same height, if it is the elastic collision. But it is not the elastic collision. Suppose if it is inelastic, when the body is dropped from a height h, after collision, whenever the body makes collision with the ground inelastically, then after collision these two stick together and the body comes to rest. But it is not the inelastic, it is the semi elastic collision. So whenever this body makes collision with this ground, after collision, as the body loses a part of their kinetic energy, then it rebounds with a velocity v1. After first collision, suppose it rebounds with a velocity say v1. So what is that velocity v1? We have to find. With this velocity it rebounds, and before its velocity becomes zero, definitely as semi-elastic collision takes place, some kinetic energy is lost. Already we have observed this. Loss of kinetic energy due to semi-elastic collision is equal to half m1 m2 by m1 plus m2 into u1 minus u2 whole square into 1 minus e square. Derive chesam kada. So after semi-elastic collision, it loses a part of kinetic energy of the body, and with the remaining kinetic energy, it rises. Definitely, v1 less than u, kabatti it cannot rise up to that height. After first collision, suppose it rises to a height of say h1. Of course, everything will occur along the same straight line. But in order to understand the situation here, I drawn the under path. But actually, the body rises along the same path like this. Okay. After first collision, again. After rises to the maximum height, again it falls and it makes collision with the ground. It makes second collision with the ground. With what velocity it rises? With the same velocity it reaches the ground and makes collision. And after collision, it rebounds with a velocity less than this velocity after second collision. After second collision, it rebounds with a velocity v2. As it is less than v1, the body cannot raise the maximum height. Okay, it reaches certain height and again they comes down. They falls. They comes down like this.
they comes down and it makes third collision. After third collision, definitely velocity with which it rebounces is less than the v2 value. Okay, then it rebounces up to a height, and again after reaches the maximum height, it makes collision with the ground again.
In this way, as long as number of collisions increases, the height up to which the body rises gradually decreases. Everything happens along the same straight line. But in order to understand the situation, I drawn different paths like this. But after every collision, the body travel along the same line only. It makes collisions like this, number of collisions, and as long as number of collisions increases, the height reached gradually decreases, and after some collisions, it comes to rest. That will happen like this. But in order to understand the situation here, I drawn different paths. Okay, now what about V1? Suppose the coefficient of restitution between the body and the horizontal surface is say E. According to the definition of the coefficient of restitution, V2 minus V1 by U1 minus U2 is the formula for coefficient of restitution. Ikkada jarige collision semi-elastic. Oka vela semi-elastic kaakapothe enta velocity collision jarigindo ade velocity rebounds avutundi. Oka vela inelastic aithe same idi deento collision jarapagane idi kuda rest loki vachestundi floor tho paatu endukante floor cannot move. Okay, so you substitute the data. After collision, it is the velocity of the second body ante idi first body ante ee dropped the body which is dropped. So v2, it is the velocity of the floor after collision. Even after collision also floor cannot move, no? That's why v2 zero minus v1. V1 ante initial ga body drop ayindi ee direction lo, body ni drop chestundi ee direction lo, kaabatti before collision its velocity is in this direction. Kani v1 daniki opposite ga undi kaabatti minus v1 by u1 ante before collision velocity of the first body ante u minus velocity of the second body before collision ante floor rest undi kaabatti zero. So that is equal to v1 by u kada, therefore v1 is equal to e into u. V1 is equal to e into u. Atlage what about v2? Before making second collision, velocity of the body is v1. After collision, velocity of the body is v2. So after collision, velocity of the body, after second collision, it is after first collision. After first collision, velocity of the body this one. After second collision, velocity of the body vt is equal to e into. Before making second collision, with what velocity it makes second collision, that velocity means v1. V1 we have to write. Before making first collision, with what velocity it makes collision means u. That's why u we have written. Before making second collision, with what velocity it makes collision means v1. That's why v1 instead of u we have to write v1. That is equal to e into v1 means e into u. You write e into u. That is equal to e square into u. After third collision, velocity with which it rebounds v3 is equal to e into. Before making third collision, with what velocity it makes collision means v2, no? That's why v2. That is equal to e into v2 means e square into u. That is equal to e cube into u. In general, after nth collision by symmetry, with what velocity it rebounds? Tell me. After nth collision, with what velocity it rebounds? You tell me. After nth collision, with what velocity it rebounds? Okay, e to power of n into u. That is equal to e to power of n into u is not given. The height from which it is dropped is given. That's why u is equal to root 2 gh. We can write now. This is the velocity with which after nth collision the body rebounds. After fifth collision, with what velocity it rebounds means e to power of 5 into root 2 gh. You will be given e value. E value what is that? So with what velocity it rebounds after fifth collision we can calculate. Okay, this is the velocity formula. Next, after first collision, how high the body rises? After first collision, the body rises up to height h1. After second collision, the body rises up to height h2. After third collision, h3. After nth collision, up to what height it rises? After nth collision, suppose the body rises up to a height, say hn. Hn is equal to question mark. After nth collision, up to what height it rises? That is the case. So whenever you see from this formula, we can use this formula also.
So velocity of the body after nth collision with which it rebounds is equal to e to power of n into root 2gh. Root 2gh means u only, no? Root 2gh is equal to u.
Okay, you write
2gh, you keep 2gh like this only. U is equal to root 2gh, no? You keep like this only. Initially, the body dropped from a height h. After nth collision, it rebounds with a velocity vn. Okay, after nth collision, when it rebounds with a velocity vn, up to what height it raises means hn, no? That's why vn can be written as root 2g into hn, no? That is equal to e to the power of n into root 2gh. Square on both sides, then 2gHn is equal to e to the power of 2n into root will be cancelled, 2gh. 2g, 2g cancel. Therefore, hn is equal to e to the power of 2n into h. So, if the body is dropped from a height h, after nth collision, it up to what height it rebounds means hn is equal to e to the power of 2n into h. After first collision, up to what height it rebounds means you put n is equal to 1. After second collision, up to what height it rebounds means you put n is equal to 2, like that. Okay, this is velocity with which it rebounds. It is the height up to which it rises after nth collision. Similarly, after nth collision, what is the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height? After nth collision, what is the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height? That is said Tn. Okay, we have to derive that formula. Initially, as the body is dropped from a height h, time taken by this body to reach the ground is equal to say t naught. Time taken by the body to reach the ground is t naught. T naught is the time of descent before making first collision. Okay, if t naught, time of descent is equal to root 2 h by g, we can write now. That is equal to time of descent before making first collision. Time of descent before making first collision. Okay. Now, after nth collision, what is the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height? That is the case. Okay. You see? Here I think we can do directly. Vn means after nth collision, as it rises with a velocity Vn, then initial along vertical, initial velocity is called Vn after nth collision. U is called Vn. Before reaches the highest point, final velocity becomes zero at highest point. Acceleration, as the body is moving vertically upwards under gravity, A is equal to minus Z. Time taken is equal to nth collision tarvata maximum height reach kodanku patte time kabatti that time is equal to say Tn. What is the relation among them? From V is equal to U plus AT. V means 0, U means Vn, plus A means Z, T means Tn. So Tn is equal to Vn by G, no? Vn is equal to, we can write this one, no? Vn is equal to e to the power of n into root 2gh by z. So therefore, of course, we can do in different ways. I am telling simple way. E to the power of n into, you write this z also inside the root. Root 2gh by z, g square. When you write this g inside the root, it becomes square. G square cancel. Therefore, Tn is equal to e to the power of n into, what about root 2h by z? This is equal to e to the power of n into root 2h by z. Now, what is root 2h by z? That is the time of descent, T naught. Time of descent. That's why this is equal to T naught. So, this is the relation between time of descent and time taken by the body to reach the maximum height after nth collision. Nth collision jaripina tarvata maximum height reach kodanku patte time idi. Before making first collision, time taken by the body to reach the ground is T naught. This is the different relations. So, ultimately, velocity of the body after nth rebounds is equal to e to power of n into velocity with which it makes collision. Next, The height reached after nth collision is equal to e to power of 2n into h. Time taken by the body to rise the to reach the maximum height after nth collision is tn is equal to e to power of n into t naught. Of course, this can be written as here e to power of n into u means root 2 gh. We can write here e to power of n into t naught means we can write root 2 h by z. These all formulas are important.
Okay. Sometimes they may ask before making second collision, what is the distance traveled? They may ask before making second collision, what is the distance traveled? First collision, in order to make the first collision, the body has to travel a distance equal to h. To make the second collision, the body has to rebound to a height h1 and again come back to the distance h1 and it makes second collision. So before making second collision, the total distance traveled is h plus h1 plus this h1. That means h plus 2h1 is the distance traveled before making second collision. They ask like that. H1 means distance, height traveled after first collision. Height traveled after first collision means you put n is equal to 1. H1 is equal to e to power of 2 into 1 into h. In that way, we had right. Okay, this is that note 1. Shall I erase this one? No, no. All these conditions are if air resistance is ignored. Air resistance unte compulsory adi kuda mention chesavandi. Air resistance is not there. Air resistance is ignored. Okay, air resistance is ignored here. Next. So today you can do some more problems based on these concepts. Remember those formulas. Fifteen minutes more is there time. Next, note 2. Total distance traveled by the body before coming to rest. Total distance traveled by the body before coming to rest. Suppose a body is dropped from a height h. Then after it comes down through a distance h, it makes first collision and it rebounds along the same path. But after collision, suppose the coefficient of restitution is say e, then after first collision, definitely it cannot rebound with the same velocity with which it makes collision. Suppose it makes collision with a velocity say u, u is equal to root 2 gh, no? But after collision, it cannot rebound with the same velocity. Definitely some energy is lost. It rebounds with a velocity say v1 and raises up to certain height, again comes down. As long as number of collisions increases, the distance traveled by the body gradually decrease, the height raised by the body gradually decreases, and after some collisions it comes to rest. But theoretically it makes infinite number of collisions before coming to rest, theoretically, not practically. Okay, so what is the total distance traveled by the body before coming to rest? That is the case. But of course, whenever collision takes place, in all cases the body travel along the same straight line only, but height raises gradually decreases and finally comes to rest. What is the total distance traveled means we cannot understand the diagram. That's why the path along which the body travel after collisions, I will draw sideways, but all will happen along the same straight line. After collision, first collision, it rises up to a height h1 and again comes down. Okay. After second collision, it rises up to a height h2 and again comes down. After third collision, it raises up to a height h3 and comes down. So this is h2, this is h3. In this way, it will happen, and so on. Total distance traveled before coming to rest, they asked. Total distance traveled before coming to rest is equal to, as initially the body is dropped from this point, before making first collision, it travel a distance h. After first collision, it travel a distance h1 and again h1 and make second collision. That's why 2h1 distance traveled. After second collision, it rises to a height h2 and again comes down through a distance h2. That's why total distance traveled to make second collision, third collision is 2h2 plus 2h3 plus and so on. Number of times it makes collision before coming to rest. Okay, so this is equal to h plus 2 into what about h1? After nth collision, up to what height the body rises means hn is equal to e to the power of 2n into h now. Hn is equal to e to the power of 2n into h. Hn is equal to e to the power of 2n into h. H1 means you put 1, n is equal to 1, then h1 is equal to e to the power of 2 into h now. E to the power of 2 into h plus 2 into h2 means you put n is equal to 2, then you will get h2. E to the power of 4 into h plus e to 2 into e to the power of 6 into h plus and so on. So in all terms, h plus, you see, in all terms we can take 2e square h common, no? 2e square h you take common, half. Here it is 1 plus here 2e square h is taken common, then remaining is e square. Plus here 2e square h is taken common, e to the power of 4, e to the power of 6, plus and so on. You will get like this. Then h plus 2e square h of 1 plus e square plus e to the power of 4 plus e to the power of 6 plus and so on means these are in GP, no? The ratio between adjacent terms remains constant, same. That's why these are in GP. In GP, since in GP, geometric progression, the sum of the infinite terms is equal to sum of infinite terms is equal to a by 1 minus r. A means first term 1 by 1 minus common ratio. Common ratio means e square by 1, e square. E to the power of 4 by e square. Common ratio is this one. So therefore, you take h also common in these two terms. Then 1 plus 2e square by 1 minus e square. H into, you take LCM. 1 minus e square plus 2e square by 1 minus e square. That is equal to h of 1 minus e square plus 2e square means 1 plus e square by 1 minus e square. This is the total distance traveled before coming to rest. Total distance traveled before coming to rest is h into 1 plus e square by 1 minus e square. Next, what is the total time taken by the body before coming to rest? What is the total time taken by the body before? This is the total distance traveled. It is the total distance. Before coming to rest, what is the displacement? Total displacement is how much? Tell me. Before coming to rest, what is the total displacement? Initially, the body is here. Finally, the body comes to rest here. So, total displacement is equal to h only, no? So, total displacement is h only. Total displacement is equal to h only. Next, when the after body is dropped from a height h, what is the time taken by the body to come rest? As long as number of collisions increase, the height reaches gradually decreases and after some collisions, it comes to rest. So what is the total time taken by the body before coming to rest? We have to derive. Last few minutes. Last few minutes. Third one. Total time taken by the body before coming to rest. Same, you see, time taken by this body to reach the ground is equal to T naught plus after first collision, it rebounds and time taken to rise the maximum height is equal to T1. And again, time taken at this body to reach the ground is also equal to T1. T1 plus T1, 2T1. Okay, before making second collision, time interval between first and second collision means after first collision, it takes T1 seconds to rise to maximum height. Again, to come down T1 seconds. So, time interval between first collision and second collision is equal to 2T1. After second collision, to make third collision, it has to rise upwards. Time taken is T2 plus again T2, 2T2. Plus 2T3 plus and so on. It is the total time taken before coming to rest. So T0 plus 2 into time taken by the body to raise the maximum height after first collision. After nth collision, time taken to raise the maximum height is equal to e to the power of n into T0, no?
So first equation means you put n is equal to 1, then e to the power of 1 into t naught plus after second collision n is equal to e square into t naught plus 2 into after third collision e cube into t naught plus and so on. Therefore, in all terms here, 2 e t naught, 2 e t naught you take common. 2 e t naught you take common. 1 plus here e plus e square plus and so on. So t naught plus 2 e t naught of here you see. Adjacent terms ratio is same. That's why sum of the infinite terms in GP, same in GP, sum of infinite terms is equal to A by 1 minus R. First term 1 by 1 minus common ratio, E by 1, E, E square by E, E, like this. So T naught you take common in both 1 plus 2E by 1 minus E. That is equal to T naught of, you take LCM, 1 minus E, plus 2e by 1 minus e, then 1 plus e by 1 minus e you will get, no? Therefore, total time taken by the body before coming to rest after it is dropped from certain height h is equal to t naught into 1 plus e by 1 minus e. But t naught is not given, h is given. That's why root 2h by z into 1 plus e by 1 minus e. This is the total time taken. Okay? So in next class we'll discuss some more points and we'll do some problems based on these concepts. Today you have to do the problems. You can do somewhat more number of problems today. Okay, right now, have a nice day. I'm signing out.